The government has a tough job to do between should they release more land?
First of all, we have to understand why the demand has been increasing for the past few months actually.
We have invited a friend, an old friend. Her name is Anne. Let's welcome Anne to the show. Hello, hello Anne.
Hi. Hi, Manuel. Hi, Danny.
Hello.
I'm so excited to be here to Kipo on the first show and excited to see myself on video.
We have shortlisted this topic for today's. All right, it's a should the government release more land sales as demand for property rises? Okay, this is an article from the Age Prop. Demand for residential property rises amid dwindling supply. This is an extract from the article. The Singapore residential property market is currently like a pot of steel on a fire that's boiling over. That fire is fueled by economic growth, household income, and low interest rate. What the government is doing is putting more stones and bricks on top of the lid of the pot to try to keep it from boiling over. But the fire is still going on, and the government cannot cool the fire because there's GDP growth. I think it's quite long read, but simply put, right, it's just saying that the government has a tough job to do between should they release more land. If they release more land, it might risk making the construction labor crunch tighter, and that may be a problem.
Well, first of all, we have to understand why the demand has been increasing for the past few months, actually, despite the ongoing pandemic. It's all come down to the fact that new projects takes a longer time to construct, especially particularly BTO. BTO get delayed, people go towards the resale market, HDB resale market, and then people who benefit after cashing out from the resale HDB market, they go on to mass market condos. And those mass market condos who sellers who have sold their property then go on to bigger properties, they go on to new launches. All this is adding actually pressure to the dwindling number of unsold units in the inventory list across the country. So for developers who are hungry for land, they really only have two choices, right? It's only either through en bloc, through the government land sales program. But the government also has this very tricky dilemma, because if they were to release a lot of land, then there'll be a lot of competition for labor and for construction materials. And as you can see from the headlines, the articles that we are showing over here, right, you can see that actually there's an intense competition these days for labor especially, because we are now having a manpower crunch due to the restrictions placed on South Asian workers.
For the part, right, although government tried to recruit more China workers, but the fact is that even in China itself, they are growing very fast. Our salary prices in Singapore is not attractive enough to bring them over.
In fact, today's Straits Times, they actually published that there's more and more Singaporean households who currently live in HDB. They are actually shifting, you know, to condominium. So there are more demands. So naturally, you know, the supply has to be more. Otherwise, the supply cannot meet the demand.
That's the dilemma. You see, if you look at the article too, right? This is by the Business Times, published on the 3rd
of June. Business Times.
Yeah, the key issue is that, yeah, the prices are rising. So a lot of developers are hungry for land. So if the government agrees to them or said, hey, yeah, let's release more land, then the problem will be, all right, it solved the supply issue. But then releasing more land might cause materials to go up. And labor, as Manuel mentioned, labor shortage, and the China workers are not coming over. So that means the construction cost might rise. And would that lead to a spiral in the price for future? So it's really between a hard place and a rock. If the government try to cool down by controlling the supply of land, or even coming up with more ABSD, it might be like putting stones on the boiling pot.
Yeah,
there's an underlying economic growth, and interest rate is really very low. And with this pandemic, everyone wanted to have a bigger space or more personal space. So these are,
to me, more from like working from home. Yeah.
Yeah. So in my personal opinion, it's more like there's a genuine fundamental reason why the demand is there. It's not like speculation.
I mean, it's in the best interest for everybody that this demand is real. You know, it's not based on speculation. It's not like a bubble forming, you know, because the last time a bubble formed, wasn't really very good, right, for everyone across the world, you know. So keeping in line with the economic fundamentals as well, the government will always want to ensure that the property prices don't rise beyond logic, you know. So everything has to be very conservative. And if you look at the government policies, right, they pretty much leave it to the market forces. They don't really have a very heavy-handed approach, you know. So what they do is they just release the government land sales. You guys bid for it. Okay, then we see how it goes from there.
So let me bring you back to some of the time sequence, because why this article captured my attention was that there's a sequence of flow. Okay, so what happened was on the 3rd of June, land supply issue came out. So on the 4th of June, this interview for all the top leaders came out on the 4th of June, which is the article for demand for residential property rising amid dwindling supply. That's all. 3rd and 4th of June. Next come, look at the slide 3. So come on June 7th, Business Time mentioned that developers, contractors are battling labor crunch, as we mentioned. So it kind of like reinforced what's happening. And from my ground experience, I have friends who are with the construction industry or renovation industry. They mentioned that, well, now finding a worker is very, very tough. So right now, the current workers who are still in Singapore right now, the foreign workers, they are actually asking for higher pay. So that's for 7th of June. On the Friday, 11th of June, then the government came out with this land sales program. So I think everything's in tandem. It's like, no, wow, 3rd, 4th, 7th, 11th June. Everything is happening. So this is something that's quite important, and it shows the government is watching.
They need to come up with more land sales. Otherwise, it'll be or maybe cooling measures, you know, something will happen.
So scary if it's another cooling measure.
Yeah, that's right.
Honestly, if you ask me, assuming let's do a role play. If I'm the government, to be honest, I also have a hard time to decide. Should I release more land or not? But knowing our government, so they are quite prudent. So I think they took a calibrated approach.
That's why, Dennis, if you look at this article, right, you can see that even though the confirmed number of units in the second half of this year's government land sales program has increased is not by a lot. It's not by a lot. It's a little bit only. I believe about 400 over units.
From 1,006 to 2,000.
So the government response is actually very tapered, very conservative actually. Yeah, because for sure they will have to release more land, because if they don't, right, the developers who are very land bank hungry, they will turn towards en bloc.
That's why when Manuel mentioned about en bloc, right, it brings me to a point. Remember in the 2017-2018, that period of time? So that was period when en bloc, there was en bloc craze. 2017-2018 was the fever.
The peak,
The government was forced to come out with the additional cooling measures in June 2018 itself. When there's a scarcity of land, government don't want to reduce the lands. But being the developers, right, they need land to survive. Just imagine, if today I'm Far East, I'm Capital Land, or I'm all the big boss developers, CDL. If you don't give me land to build, I can't win any land plot from the GLS program. So what can I do? Do I have to disband my staff and ask them to take a break? Not possible, right? So I just need to have a land. So you don't give me land, I'll go to on block. No choice. During the period of time, 2017-2018, they say, oh, maybe to cool down the market, I release less land. End up, people going for on block.
Actually, I also noticed that most of the land size are not so big. Release of the land size, and even if they release, right, it's actually I feel that the bidders will also, you know, if they are hungry, the developers are hungry for land, so naturally they will bid higher. Look at the recent one, the Tengah Garden Walk. I think the price is so expensive for EC. It's 603, the highest bid, 603. If you compare to Pasir Ris 8 is only at how much? 684. So it's
is an integrated
Imagine you're comparing with an EC at Tengah, it's a non-mature estate, and it's an EC at 603. Also 64.
I think Tengah is still not an estate yet. It's a estate to be not mature.
Precisely, I cannot believe it. You know, when I look at the figure, then I was like, oh my god. So how much are they going to launch? Is it going to be at 1,002 and 1,003 for an EC?
Wow.
So it's a fact that if land price is going to increase, construction cost is going to be increased. So there's no way the property price can be rewind back to the old price itself.
Exactly.
Even for this time, right now, for this article, on the 11th of June, the government increased the GLS units from 1,006 to 2,000, as you mentioned. So actually, 1,006 to 2,000, at this 2,000 units, actually is very conservative. Why do I say that? Because this article also mentioned that As compared to the 2010 and 2012, right, there was two periods where the government released 7,000 to 8,000 units. So can you imagine 7,000 to 2,000? That's a big difference. So yes. And from this article, right, it shows that okay, these plots of land includes EC, private condo, white sites,
hotel sites. Yeah, white sites.
And most of these are on the reserve list. When you sell the land, there's two lists. One is called the confirmed list. Just give me the best price and I will let go of this land itself. For the reserve list, they will not put up for auction or for bidding. If anyone is interested, you submit your bid and you must submit adhere to the minimum bid. Then the government say, okay, you give me a deposit. Then you take out the land. So it's very prudent based on demand and supply itself. So this is really a calibrated approach.
I believe for all of us, if you told us 7 years ago that brand new EC will hit 1,000 PSF, we wouldn't believe.
Nobody would believe.
Yeah, but look at the reality now, especially for this EC at the Piedmont side. If you all know what I mean, yes.
The current EC already over 1,000 PSF.
So all these land prices, even if the government response is very tapered and measured, right, it only shows that land prices are increasing, right? Increasing everywhere, not just EC, but even the private residential, probably in the dairy farm side, probably in the tembusu side as well, you know, and especially this right side that Dennis has mentioned.
Yeah, so and actually for me and Manuel, we did a video, last video was about this property prices. So landed price per record, condo rose, HDB rose, even rental rose. So everything is rising.
Inflation.
It's a bit scary.
It's so scary that for consumers who are looking at our videos and maybe reading the news, right, they might be thinking, hey, everything is increasing so quickly. When is the best time to buy?
Actually, the best time to buy. Now.
That it doesn't exist. It's actually now. If you can afford it, if it's within your means, now is always the best time.
Okay, right? Penny, you should put it this way. Be it stock market, be it property, there's no way you can time so well that I always sell at the peak. There's also no way you can time yourself that I'll always buy at the lowest. No way.
Yeah.
So it's just that along in between, no one is God, no one's guru.
If you want the time, you will miss.
Yeah.
Of course, you do your homework, plan your finance, and somehow you must press a button. So, from my experience, sometimes like, if you dare not press a button within a year, then you might not be pressing the button after all. I call it the press a button. It's quite scary to press a button. Because once you press a button, it's buying a property, a lot of pressure will come in. To be honest, a lot of pressure will come in. Wow, your mortgage, your stamp duty, I cannot lose my job, I have to work harder. Just now that I got a baby, this baby is a property.
That's why we have to buy prudently. We need to do, you know, the proper financial planning.
Back to this article. On the 11th of June, this article, white site at Marina View triggered from the surface. So this is a white site. That means, right, wow, that means the demand is actually there.
It's actually very interesting and I always love white site no matter what. Because because you can actually have, there's no restriction to me. You know, it's like, it's so flexible. I can build residential, I can build commercial, and I can have grade A offices there. I can even have hotels, service apartment, or retail shops. So it's like, you know, everything under one roof when the development is built. Selling price will also be very much higher compared to, you know, just a typical residential or just a mixed development. Yeah.
Now that you mentioned this, white site and Marina View has been triggered for 1.508 billion. That's a big sum of money. I think this whole site, right, is actually, to me, it's quite exciting because this is going to be part of the Marina Bay growth, which will be the next CBD. So after this 11th of June article, white site released from Marina View. So you look at slide 6, this June 16th article, URA launches 2-1-North GLS site for sale.
Very recent only, Dennis. Very recent only.
I'm very excited over this too.
Can you see the sequence? Because I know that your Marina was involved in the
one-off hidden.
One of the sales. So that was quite good sales. It's a small project, but the sales is pretty good. So now that
I sold a couple of units there because my investor, they are actually waiting. So in fact, this area, one-north area, right, it's actually part of the District 5. But District 5, I mean, if you look at the vacancy rate, that means vacancy rate for rental, because when you buy property, especially for investors, so what do they normally look at? They want to know the rentability of the development. Am I right? So when you look at rentability, so you would like to know, okay, District 5, there's so many areas. You have Clementi, you have Pasir Panjang, where Buona Vista. Yeah, and one of there. Yeah, in fact, if you look at the lease, right, of the vacancy, you know, demand for rental, actually the One North residences and the Rochester Park residences is actually very, very highly sought after. So which means to say that, you know, this One North Eden will be actually the next sought after development over there due to the development of the whole area. My investors, they bought 2 bedrooms and 3 bedrooms because for One North Eden, we only have 165 units. So very sad. I still have three of them that didn't manage to get any units that they want. Yeah, because fully sold.
What do you think will be the rental when TOP, what's likely rental for your 2-bedroom for the entire
2-bedroom, we could easily fetch close to 3.8 to 4K.
For 2-bedroom?
Yes. Very maneuverable. Yeah.
Achievable. Yeah, for Rochester residences, they're actually bigger in terms of units. I mean, unit size, they are bigger. So they can rent up to 4.8 to 5K. It's also possible. Yes. 3-bedroom, because theirs are very big unit. So that is why, actually I have quite a number of investors, they couldn't get a unit at One North Eden. So they actually told me that, let's wait, because I told them, it looks like there's another 2 plots, you know, just opposite One North Eden. So 他们在等, they were like waiting, okay, when will it be out? Please let us know. So right now, I saw this news.
So it's open for you. These 2 plots are open for you.
So very excited. Everyone is waiting.
Overall, for this the topic that we are discussing today, we're seeing that actually the government has responded to what's happening. So they are watching. They are trying to be prudent. They don't want the price to run away. Since they put most of the sites on reserve list and the demand came in, so it's really a very genuine demand from the developer itself. Yeah. So I think it's a fair approach. So for Manuel, anything else to add?
Well, I think that like what we have mentioned earlier on, if you are planning to take action, now would be the best time. But exercise prudence, always do your due diligence. While stocks last, never overstretch. Because I have been serving buyers for looking for 1 to 2 bedrooms, and I realized, interestingly enough, what the supply for 1 and 2 bedrooms all across the country for new launches is on the low side. Not much 1 to 2 bedrooms left for, everywhere else. So while you can, go for it.
We are on the ground agent. So for us, you know, every day, you know, it really plays a part for us to understand, you know, how all these things work and how does it actually integrates into our daily lives and the impact for investors as well.
I think to be fair, all these views and opinions are our own comments. We might not be right. It's up to you to make the final conclusion. Is it right or wrong? Whether to take the next step or not, is it tomorrow or this next year? It's up to you. But I think it's going to be quite fun. If you need any help from us to answer your questions, feel free to leave your comments or give us a call from this number itself. So with that, we end this show today. So thanks, guys. See you in our next video.
Thank you.
Thanks for watching.
Thank you. Bye. Bye. Bye.